Welcome to this lecture on artificial intelligence for improved dementia diagnosis. My name is Wiro Niessen. I'm professor of biomedical image analysis at Erasmus MC and Delft University of Technology. I'm also linked to Quantip, which is a spin-off company from Erasmus MC. And I present this lecture on behalf of the Academic Center of Excellence for Alzheimer of the Erasmus MC, where we bring research, patient care, and education together to advance our possibilities to deal with Alzheimer's disease. I think nowadays it's almost important not to notice the enormous impact of artificial intelligence. If you speak about self-driving cars or your phone, in which you have speech recognition nowadays, it all is because of artificial intelligence. In our field, especially the field of analyzing images, the breakthrough in artificial intelligence came in 2012. In 2012, there was a competition, and it was won by a network to recognize objects in images. So whether to determine from a photograph automatically by a computer algorithm, whether, for example, an elephant was present, or whether a house or a sailboat was present. And the special thing about this algorithm, that it was just trained from examples. So a lot of examples were given to a neural network, and this neural network trained itself to perform a task. And it blew the competition out of the water. And since then, many academic institutes and companies have started to use artificial intelligence to address many tasks. And why is this ImageNet competition and this artificial intelligence so successful? The reason lies in the enormous amount of data that was available for training algorithms and for the accurate labeling and the technology. If we look at the reason for success, it's really having access to large data to train from and state-of-the-art AI technology. But if we can use it to recognize images in real pictures, can we translate this success of artificial intelligence to healthcare? I myself have been working for many years in the field of medical image analysis, and we turn these beautiful images into quantifications in order to make the whole process of diagnosis more objective and quantitative. But what if we can go one step further? What if we can learn from all these image data about what is relevant for the patient? Will my disease progress? Will this therapy be successful or not? What is the chances on success? In the beginning, in the medical field, perhaps there was also a bit of concern because of this artificial intelligence. Will the field of medicine become less human? Will doctors be replaced? There's a very nice saying, anything you can do, I can do better, where I obviously stands for artificial intelligence. Is this the future? I don't think so. Even though in the beginning it seems there was a competition, man versus machine, I think it's much more now that the man with the machine is better than the man without the machine. We see it everywhere in our society. And specifically, artificial intelligence can help doctors to learn from previous patients to treat the next patient better. That's the field of precision medicine, utilizing knowledge that you could derive from previous patients in order to do a better diagnosis and prognosis for today's patients. So, as I said, artificial intelligence needs data. And here in Rotterdam, in order to study how Alzheimer's disease develops, we have a very rich source of data. It's linked to a population study, the Rotterdam study. So in the Rotterdam study, what we do is from a large number of people, people 45 years and older, we collect a lot of data. We collect those data of which we think they may be risk factors of disease. And our question, of course, is which risk factors determine that some people age healthy and that other people get a disease. And the risk factors we're looking at are, for example, your genetic liability for disease, your lifestyle, environmental factors, etc. And then we're interested in outcomes. So we follow people over time and see who, for example, gets a stroke or develops dementia. And with these data, we can see what risk factors there are for these diseases. But still, the relationship between risk factors and outcome is a black box. And to unravel this black box, in the Rotterdam study, we started to collect imaging data at a large scale. So every 3 to 4 years, the subjects that participate in the Rotterdam study are being scanned, and we can see what's happening in the brain. And in this way, we can relate risk factors to what happens in the brain, and we can relate risk factors and what happens to the brain to relevant clinical outcomes. And in this way, we can start to understand better which risk factors there are, and also whether we can predict whether someone will get Alzheimer's or not. So this has turned the way I study and my group is working in the Rotterdam study and in the AIDS Alzheimer in sort of a data science factory in which we extract a lot of information of the brains of the participants of the Rotterdam study in order to understand what is the relationship of information in the image data to relevant clinical outcomes. And for this, we use this advanced artificial intelligence. We extract many aspects of the brain fully automatically. We, for example, extract the brain tissues, the white matter, the gray matter. We look at the presence of white matter lesions and where they are located, because their location probably has an impact on what their effect will be on cognition of our patients. We look at how different regions in the brain communicate. And all of this is done with these advanced image analysis tools that are supported with artificial intelligence. And then we make the next step. How do we bring this to the clinic? For this, we collaborate. Eventually, tools need to be brought to the patient through collaboration of companies, because software developed in our academic setting needs to be approved by regulatory bodies. So in this case, we ourselves initiated a company from Erasmus MC, Quantip, in which the tools that had been developed within Erasmus MC were used at the basis of developing a tool. And what this tool does is for the clinician compute for an individual patient the same aspects of the brain as we did in the Rotterdam study, but then we get a lot of markers that reflect aspects of the brain of the patient, but we can compare this to a reference population. So if we see, for example, abnormal shrinkage of the brain, which is a pattern we see in certain forms of dementia, or if we see certain vascular pathologies, which are much more than you would expect of a person of that age, we know quantitatively that something is wrong and that may have implications for this patient. So here you see an example of the type of quantitative analysis that now are supported by artificial intelligence. So you turn this beautiful image of the brain into a quantitative description of aspects of the brain, and you're also capable to compare of an individual patient's those measurements to a reference population. Compare this to what you would do with children if they develop. You're interested whether their growth pattern is normal, whether their body weight and their length develops normal. Here we're looking at when people age, is the brain anatomy still developing normal, or are there abnormalities? And with artificial intelligence, we can start to link that to relevant diagnoses. So I think if you look into the future, what we'll see is that we're increasingly, with this availability of data and AI technology, we move to a more data-driven approach to medicine, in which we utilize data of previous patients to treat the next patient better. And this, because of artificial intelligence, will not become a less human type of medicine. No, I think rather it can be a much more human form of medicine, because clinicians will be aided to compare the status of a patient to reference data in order to provide him or her with the information which is necessary to take the right decisions concerning, for example, different treatment options. So it's very important that we increase the collection of data throughout the lifespan so we can learn from these data in order to perform the next generation of medicine. This requires an infrastructure. Ideally, I would like that we can learn from every single patient that is admitted somewhere in order to need to treat the next patient better. We have to unlock that potential. And I think infrastructure is needed for that, and we are working with Erasmus MC, with our collaborators, to establish such an infrastructure. Once you have all these data and you can learn from them, you can try to derive with artificial intelligence the relationship between these rich data sets and what is relevant for the clinician and the patient. And in this way, you can improve detection of disease, early detection. You can try to improve diagnosis and prognosis, and thus advance the therapy in case of dementia. And this all will bring us a step further towards a learning healthcare system in which we utilize both data and state-of-the-art artificial intelligence technology to optimally learn from data to treat the tomorrow's patients better. I would like to thank you very much for your attention, and also I would like to introduce the next speaker, Harro, who will also talk about this aspect of how AI and human knowledge may go together, and he will do that from a clinical perspective. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Wiro. I will talk you through the second part of this lecture called A Man vs. Machine, a Clinical Perspective. My name is Harro Seelaar. I'm a neurologist at the Department of Neurology and the Alzheimer's Center Erasmus MC. Who are we? We are a team of neurologists, geriatricians, psychiatrists, radiologists, nuclear radiologists, neuropsychologists, and we also have a dementia case manager. We see patients referred by general practitioners or second or third opinions from other memory clinics. And we've got weekly multidisciplinary meetings at the Erasmus MC. A very brief diagnostic process. What we do, every patient is evaluated by either a neurologist or a geriatrician, and they will get a neuropsychological examination and they will get an MRI. Then we discuss them, and after that, a part of the patient will get a lumbar puncture. And what we can do with that is we can look at proteins to diagnose Alzheimer's disease. Some of them will get an FTD PET scan, a nuclear scan, and some will get a DNA diagnostic test. In this part of the lecture, I will talk you through a couple of cases in which MRI and quantum is used. The first case is a 69-year-old woman, and she was referred for a second opinion whether she had Alzheimer's disease or not. She already had 2 years progressive short-term memory deficits, but she also had a lot of word-finding problems. She had a mini mental state examination. That's a routine test to look at cognitive functions, and she scored 13 out of 40, and you want to be above at least 24. She had also had a neuropsychological examination, and what we see was she had a head turning sign. What that means, she was constantly looking to her partner because she couldn't answer the questions. She was actually not really motivated for extensive testing, but already on screening tests, you could see severe memory deficits. And there were also visual constructive errors, and that showed this picture here. There are two overlapping figures, and she was not able to do that, to reconstruct that. And that's something you typically see in Alzheimer's disease. If you look at the MRI, and what we do in every meeting, we've got a visual rating by the radiologist, and we also use Quantib. And what you see is, you can see here atrophy of the hippocampus in the green. You can see where the hippocampus is, and they give you a score, the radiologist, and it's MTA2, and that's for her age too much atrophy. Also, if you look pictures on the left, you could see parietal lobe atrophy, so on the back of the head, you see atrophy. And if we use Quantib, you see on the left, you see the percentage of the intracranial volume, and on the right side, the percentile. So you can look at the age, you can see on the x-axis the age, and you could see that she's very low in compared to other normal people from the same age. And also in the other pictures, you see the red dot. It's far below what you would expect for the age. So it's too much atrophy for age. And this profile, also in a clinical presentation, that fits the diagnosis Alzheimer's disease. So here there's a good agreement between MRI by the visual rating and using QuantTip. A second case, there was also a second opinion with the question whether it was frontotemporal dementia or Alzheimer's disease. And that was a 52-year-old male, and he presented with disinhibition. He was a childish behavior, and he had absolutely no insight in his disease. He actually had no complaints. But there were also very severe language comprehension and naming deficits. A question we ask at the outclinic department is, for example, tell us which animal has a very long neck. And he couldn't tell us that that could be a giraffe. And also the other way around, what is typical of a giraffe? He couldn't tell that the animal has got a very long neck. He underwent neuropsychological testing, and there were severe language deficits, especially naming deficits, also social recognition tasks, they were very impaired. But the visual construct functions, like the other case before, they were spared. We did a lumbar puncture, and that was normal, so there was no Alzheimer's disease. And there were also some other family members with dementia. And the DNA diagnosis showed a mutation in the TARDP gene, and that fits the diagnosis FTD, frontal temporal dementia. If we look at the MRI, you could see in the on the especially also on the middle picture, there's on the temporal lobe there's a lot of atrophy. You see if you look at the back, that it's normal volume, and if you go towards the eyes, this is the temporal lobe. There's severe atrophy. And if you look at the QuantTip bars on the under, it's not even on the map. That's as severe as it is. But the visual rating was only temporal atrophy, and the other regions were normal. And QuantTip also showed some frontal atrophy. And if we if you look at the picture of the frontal lobe, it's below what's normal for the age. And it was a young case, 52 years. And that helped us to look in detail back to the frontal lobe. And indeed, there was some frontal atrophy. We were looking so much at the severe atrophy, we missed the frontal lobe atrophy. I also have a third case, and that was also a second opinion, whether there was a dementia or there was a mood disorder. And it was a 59-year-old male, and he had mainly short-term memory problems for already 5 years. They were not really increasing, but he also had some mood problems. The short test, the mini mental state, was 30 out of 40. That's a maximum score. And we did a neuropsychological examination twice, and all the scores were within normal range, and there was also it was also stable. The MRI showed no atrophy visually, and we also performed an FTG PET, and that showed no hypometabolism. So that was all, everything was normal, and we concluded there was no dementia. But then we looked again to the MRI, and the radiologist showed the visual rating showed no atrophy, but QuantTip showed, and you can see that on the pictures at the bottom, on the front, the total brain volume was normal within the age range, but the frontal lobes were on the 7th percentile, so that was very low. We looked at it many times, but we couldn't find any discrepancies with the other age related people. So we think it's still normal. So what can we tell? Can the machine help us? It helps us to increase the confidence of visual rating of the radiologist or the neurologist. But it's still work in process between the visual and QuantTip rating. For example, we for some dementias, you want to look not on on volume of the lobe, but more on the volume of gyrus, and that's a smaller part, and we are not yet able to quantify that. I haven't shown in this presentation, but many cases also, especially when the age increases, you see a lot of white matter lesions. And it would help us if we could say whether that's age related or is that too much for age, and could help us with the diagnosis probably. So in conclusion, the machine is helpful for men and women and is already part of our team. Thank you for watching.